Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat, episode 338, featuring the second installment of my interview with Mr. Julian Gollop, the creator of XCOM. In this part of the interview, we talk about XCOM, XCOM 2. We talk about the importance of game audio, how that can really add to the immersion of games. We also talk about some of Julian's earliest games, including Time Lords, Nebula, and Islandia. A lot of great stuff here, so without further ado, here is Mr. Julian Gollop.
It's fun you had mentioned the sound of that Commodore 64, because some of the other interviews I read, you always kind of come back to this, how important it is to have good sound effects and music. I think that's one of the things you said about... who was it? The XCOM, the guy that you were working with on the original XCOM.
Yeah, so John Broomhall, who did the music. Yes, yeah, he did a tremendous job. Very atmospheric.
Yeah, you said something along the lines of it was you could hear something but you couldn't see it, and that really added to the experience. And as soon as I read that, I thought, you know, that is absolutely right. Wouldn't be the same game without that.
Yes.
Do you feel like that? Most designers feel that way. Is sound effects kind of an afterthought for most people?
It's getting much more sophisticated in games now. I think it is used very effectively in many games. It's maybe a bit more difficult to use it effectively in strategy games, but I think it can be done well. Actually, I think the sound design for XCOM 2 is fantastic. Unfortunately, the way the game works, you don't quite have that sense of the aliens coming at you out of the darkness that was in the original XCOM. It's more like you stumbling upon the aliens who then suddenly react.
Yeah, I just finished XCOM 2 a couple of days ago.
Oh, really? Okay. Wow,
yeah, really. It was hard. I'm one of those guys, I don't know how you feel about this, but every time one of my characters would die, I would just reload and do the battle over again.
Yeah, I mean, I've also been playing XCOM 2. I've got to the final mission, but I haven't quite finished that yet. I have reloaded when soldiers died, but I think there's maybe a couple of occasions where I didn't do that. So I just, you know, said, oh, he's dead. Forget it. I didn't like him anyway.
Yeah, I did that too. I'm like, I can't believe you had a 90% chance to hit and you still missed. You know, you deserve to die. So you sound like you're liking the XCOM 2 then?
Yeah, I thought it was a fantastic game.
You liked the first reboot too, right?
Yes, I did. I think XCOM 2's added quite a lot more. Some things are a little bit controversial, but I think the mission generator that generates the maps and sets up the missions is just amazing.
Controversial? What was that?
Well, controversial points in XCOM 2, I guess, are the turn timer system. Now, a lot of players don't like being pressured to fulfill an objective within a specific number of turns.
Oh, yeah. That
It is tough. I mean, it's one of the things that makes XCOM 2 quite difficult. I didn't have a big problem with them, I must admit. I thought it did make the game more tense. You know, it forced you to take a few risks, for sure. But it also forced you to explore the capabilities of your soldiers and all the different abilities that they might have and how they interact a lot more. You know, how to use the stealth system, the concealment system better, so on.
Yeah, that really tripped me up, that timer. I like to just slowly, methodically explore the whole map and then suddenly rush you in pell-mell.
Yeah, I screwed up a whole mission. I didn't get my squad to the evac point in time, and it said to me at the end of the mission that they all got captured. And I thought, screw that. I'm going to reload that one and start again.
There was one mission there where I was out of moves, and I had this one soldier left, and I was so disappointed, like, oh, man. I guess I had so many lucky rolls to get here and everything. Now I'm going to have to restart. And then I realized that she had that suit on that had the grappling hook.
Yeah.
So I was able to use that to get to the evac point. And,
yeah, that's pulled me out of a few tricky situations, too.
I'll tell you, you were kind of critical of, I don't know if you were that critical or not, but You had some things to say about the first game and those Terra missions.
Yeah.
It seemed like the second game has something similar.
It does, yeah.
Have they made that better, or is it still just as
bad? Happening, and you've got to pick one of those things.
What is it about those things that you don't like?
What is it? I don't like it. It feels a bit contrived, and not, you know, what's the story behind these three things happening simultaneously? And it's not. It's just like the designers have said, well, we're going to make you choose something here. So here are three things. Pick one. And it kind of breaks the fourth wall, I guess, if you want to call it. It's not. It doesn't seem something that's a consequence of what the aliens are actually doing. It seems like a contrivance of game design.
That sort of breaks your suspension of disbelief, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. Huh.
All right, so I wanted to get back into the early history a little bit. So you'd mentioned a couple of times how important board games were to you, and you played them with your family. And I was wondering, I guess this was been your brother Nick that you played with, and maybe your mom and dad. I don't know if you had other brothers and sisters. Just trying to get a picture in my head of what this was like.
Yeah, absolutely. My father was the main inspiration because he used to buy board games for us once every Christmas. Yeah, I mean, he would buy a new board game for each Christmas, and we used to play lots of board games at Christmas. And this became a tradition in our family that we wouldn't sit down and watch TV. We'd play board games endlessly and card games as well.
What were some of your favorites from that period?
Oh, my goodness. There's quite a few. I think Escape from Colditz was one of the big favorites with my family. And I think we've even played that with my grandparents as well. It's a board game that we played a lot. I can't remember so many games. That's the one that stands out for sure.
It sounds like you're playing a lot more than the usual sorts of Monopoly and Risk and all that.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, although we did play those as well, of course.
I know you've made some of your own board games. Is that something that's kind of somewhere in the back of your mind? You'd like to make some more board games at some point, or are you just not interested in that?
I love to. Yeah, I mean, when I was working at Ubisoft, I think I made a couple of board games while I was there, which we used as part of our game design training. So I tried to get members of the game design team to design board games and stuff as well. So it was something that we did, which was kind of fun, but also useful as for training.
I wonder if you could just elaborate a little bit on that. That's kind of interesting. So they're making video games, but they're thinking about a board game. Is helpful?
Yeah, so it helps very much with for budding game designers in the computer games industry to get them to make a board game. Usually the instructions were to, you know, keep it very simple. Sometimes we gave them very specific sets of requirements for the board game. You know, you must be multiplayer, it must use just the only tools you've got are this piece of paper and this pencil and this dice, for example. And they have to write the rules for the game as well and then demonstrate it. You had these little game design workshops, they were split into teams, they had to create the game, play it with members of the other team and write down the rules, and it was analyzed by the other game designers. So it forced the game designers to think very carefully about rules and how to document rules, how to actually write rules, which is very helpful for their documentation skills when it comes to computer games, of course.
I like that. I mean, if you can make a fun game with just those little bit of resources, imagine what you can do when you have all the bells and whistles, right?
Yeah.
I saw a couple of photos of you, and it looked like you were at a Renaissance fair, Renaissance festival kind of situation. Do you go to those?
No, I think you're probably talking about the photo where we were all dressed up in sort of medieval. This was a promotional photo for our game Magic and Mayhem, which we did for Virgin Interactive, our publisher. We just did that in one afternoon at some local place, historical place. And We all dressed up in different clothes. I was supposed to be dressed as a wizard, even though I didn't look like one, and we had dressed as soldiers and so on. But yeah, that was just a promo shot.
Well, you were playing Dungeons and Dragons or when you were a teenager.
Yeah.
So you're playing Dungeons and Dragons, you're playing all these strategy games, and you got into all the, since it seemed like you got into Avalon Hill games and Games Workshop, a bunch of these really complex games. Obviously, that shaped your game designs later on, but I thought I would ask if you think playing all those games might have affected your world outlook or the way you experience the world.
I'm not sure exactly. I'm not sure they did affect my world outlook. No, I mean, that really came from reading books and reading science fiction. Some games, well, I don't know, if any's had a real big impact on me. Some of the war games that I played I thought were really interesting, the historical ones. I mean, these were mostly published by Avalon Hill, SPI, of course, and GDW to some extent. But then when I got interested in science fiction, it was all about how all these worlds are created. And that was interesting for me.
You play a lot of Traveller?
Yeah, Traveller. I really loved Traveller. I couldn't find people to play it with me most of the time, but I thought it was a fantastic system.
All right, well, let's get into your first game. And I saw some different accounts on this, Julian. Some places said that Islandia was the first. Then I saw other ones that said Time Lords was the first. So I thought I would just ask you.
Time Lords was the first computer game that I designed, yes.
Can you talk a little bit about that game, what it was like?
So again, this started as a paper and pencil game, and it was a very simple idea that a universe is generated, and which consists of like 5 planets and 15 time zones. And there was a little algorithm that generated the history of the 5 races that began on those 5 planets, and they can improve their civilization level, as I call it. And then they could try and send some forces off to another planet, try and colonize it there. They might fight wars with other races there, and the winner will survive and continue to flourish. So that was basically it. So it pre-generated this universe, and then you as a Time Lord could travel in time and space. So you could go to any of the 5 planets and any of the 15 time zones. And when you got there, you had to try and find out what had happened, and you are a representative of one of those 5 races. So basically, you've got to find the wars that that your race took part in, go to that war, and then change the result of that war if it lost the war. And then it would regenerate the future of the universe from that point.
That sounds great.
So you are a Time Lord altering history in the favor of your chosen race. So
there's no relation to Doctor Who at all, huh?
Well, obviously inspired by it. But of course, Doctor Who didn't change history in such a dramatic way. The aim of the game was to precisely to do that.
You ever play Universe, or was it Space, or Empire?
What, the computer games? Mm-hmm. Empire was the very early sort of conquest game. I think I did play that a long time ago, yes.
What about the am I saying this right? Islandia?
Islandia.
Islandia?
Yeah.
So that one, obviously, that's the one that's set on a sort of randomly generating island, right? And
yeah, it's kind of like a very simple 4X game, I guess, with a randomly generated map.
So I guess you had both these games and you were going to these computer fairs and trying to sell them and plastic bags?
Exactly, yes, yeah. Well, I was working with a group of guys, we call ourselves Redshift. They were basically the publisher. They published Time Lords, Islandia, and my next 2 games.
You sold a lot of copies?
I can't remember. Not a lot, no.
Have you seen, I know you were interviewed for it, but that From Bedrooms to Billions documentary?
Yes.
So I was watching that, and that was a really a treat for me, because being and growing up in America is very different. It seemed like a very different experience than growing up there. And I was really intrigued by this whole idea of the programmers and designers being sort of celebrated in the media as basically rock stars.
So yeah,
did you get some of that treatment?
No, not really. No, I mean, there was an element of that, but I think it's mostly hype by some companies, like this company called Imagine, who tried to hype this seriously. And I mean, there were a few bedroom coders like me who did get some notoriety. Some of them are, you know, still around today, like David Braben, of course, who made Elite Dangerous. When he made the original Elite, that was a huge, huge game. And there were some who kind of disappeared into obscurity, like the guy who made Manic Miner, a guy called Matthew Smith, made these two really popular games, and he just disappeared.
Did you know these guys in person back then?
No, I didn't know, no. I was very isolated, to be honest. I met people at ZX Microfair. So, for example, I met several people who made famous games, like Mike Singleton, who made Lords of Midnight. But once those Microfairs kind of stopped, I was kind of isolated again. So I didn't really know anybody else who was making games professionally like I was.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Nebula.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure exactly when that one came out. I saw it described as a 4X game about expanding and colonizing the galaxy.
Yeah, I programmed it in 1983. It was either published in 1983, and I think it was published in 1983. It's basically a 4X game, yeah. Before 4X games were sort of invented, I guess, I made one. And you literally had to, you know, it was set in the galaxy. You had to explore the galaxy, find out the races that were in there, expand your empire, exploit the resources, and ultimately fight the other empires that were there.
It sounds a little bit like Time Lords, but I guess there's a lot more to it, right?
No, this is much more. It's much more similar to. It's like a very simple version of Master of Orion, for example.
Oh. So how did that game take off, or what was the?
I think it sold reasonably well. Obviously, only sold in UK, but I can't remember any sales figures for it, I'm afraid.
And that was done on the ZX Spectrum in BASIC.
Yep.
Was that the Spectrum or the ZX81?
It's the BASIC language that was built into the ZX Spectrum. The Spectrum had actually a lot more memory because it had 48K memory, which in those days was a big deal because, you know, you're stepping up from ZX81, maybe had a 16K RAM pack, but up to 48K was pretty big.
That's all for this week's episode. I hope you guys enjoyed that. Should be back next week with part three of my interview with Mr. Gollop. I'll have at least one more, maybe two more segments with him. And then after that, it'll be time for another retrospective. So a lot of great stuff coming up. And by the way, if you like these episodes and you want to see more, then please go to that Patreon link in the show notes to contribute. A lot of you already have, and I am greatly, greatly appreciative to all of you who have supported the show. Remember, there's multiple ways you can support Matt Chat. One, of course, just go to the Patreon link and sign up for a subscription to that. You basically get charged however much you want per episode, whatever you think the show is worth. I recommend $1, but if you can afford more, hey, I'm going to turn that down. Also, though, I really appreciate it if you will help me spread the word about the show. So I know there's a lot of folks out there that would love to hear from, you know, Julian Gollop of XCOM, for, you know, crying out loud. They just don't know the channel exists, believe it or not. So if you know some people that would like to hear this interview, please send them a link, Facebook, tweet, email, whatever. I really appreciate it, guys, and thank you very much for your support. So what about that news from the Mad King? got some pretty interesting news this time. Four whole items. So let's get started here. Number one, David Beatty, a longtime friend of the show, wrote in about Megawars.net. They have entered the alpha testing phase, and they are looking for player input as they finalize the user interface and gameplay. If you're willing to provide constructive feedback to this MMO space strategy game, email David B. at Megawars.net for admittance to the alpha test server. And don't forget to mention Matt sent you. So I'll put a link in the show notes there to Megawars.net. Second item, Shane wrote in about the developers of a legacy World of Warcraft server. This is a vanilla server. Apparently, what happened, Blizzard shut them down. This was just a fan base, a fan group, I suppose. But the news, that's not really unusual, but the news is that Blizzard Entertainment is having a meeting with this team. And it's kind of up in the air, I guess, about what they're hoping to accomplish here, but it sounds pretty hopeful. This team is called the Nostorius team. I got a quote from them here. It says, "We feel we are now not only the admins of a private server, we are also the ambassadors of a larger movement for the entire World of Warcraft community that wants to see game history restored," they wrote. So this is pretty good news for historians such as yours truly, who like to, you know, play World of Warcraft like it was back when they first conceived of the game. I get a feel for that sort of look and feel of it in a historical sense. So it's good, in my opinion. I don't know how Blizzard's going to eventually try to work things out. But anyway, this is promising news, at least in my opinion. Let's see. Third bit of news, also from Shane. I'm calling this un-news. So I was all set to tell you about this new Kickstarter project from John Romero and Adrian Carmack. Not John Carmack, but Adrian Carmack. About their Blackroom project, but unfortunately, they've already canceled it. So they're claiming that this is, let's see, how do they word this? They're putting it on pause until they've developed a playable demo. And if you haven't seen this Kickstarter pitch video yet, I guess it's probably still up there. But anyway, it's described as a visceral, action-packed FPS set in a holographic simulation gone rogue. Kind of Doom meets Tron, I guess. Anyway, it looked pretty interesting to me, so hopefully they'll get that back on track soon. He also wrote in about one called Stellar Tactics, which was a turn-based space RPG. But that actually got canceled before I even got to the page to see what it was what it was all about. So I think, in my opinion, these guys are shutting down Kickstarters way too soon. You know, I can't even get to them before they're already pulled. Off of that soapbox, fourth item is from Richard Moss. He wrote in, says, "I thought you might be interested in a book I'm writing about the history of Mac gaming." Apparently that exists. He says, "I think it'll be right up your alley, actually. A deep but accessible read on the people behind a little-known and underappreciated indie game space in the 80s and 90s. So I'm barely aware of that kind of activity, so that's definitely interesting. He says, "Former Mac game evangelist and Spectre co-creator Craig Freer, is co-authoring about 10% of the book." And he's got a link here to, I'll put the link in the show notes, but it's unbound.co.uk/books/Mac gaming. So keep an eye out for that in the show notes if you want to read about the history of Macs and gaming. All right, what about that drink of the week? This week I've got a little number here called the Wild Poppy Blood Orange Chili. This is made with organic blood orange juice, agave nectar, and habanero pepper. So I love all those things in isolation, but this is the first time I've had them blended together into a drink. And I've already poured it here into this glass so you can see see what it looks like. It's very dark and cloudy. You can see little bits of stuff floating in there. I'll pour it in the drinking horn here for a proper sampling. Let's see if I can do this. No need to worry about losing its fizz or anything. It's not a soda. You definitely smell of that sort of orangey, it almost like kind of a grapefruit. I guess that's the blood orange. Anyway, you definitely smell that citrusy component. Not smelling anything that smells peppery though. It smells quite nice. Let's give it a taste. Wow. That is really nice. It tastes like orange juice, but then you get this sort of pleasant heat like you would with the, I guess, one of the stronger ginger beers. It's quite sweet, but I think they've really nailed that balance of the heat and the sweet. It's really, let me try it again here. Yeah, it's a really, really good beverage. I mean, I love that heat at the end. You get sort of a pineapple-y flavor here. Maybe that's the agave. I don't really know. But you definitely taste a lot of citrus, a lot of orange. And then that heat comes in just at the end there. Not overpowering, or it doesn't make you cough or sputter or anything. Just adds a nice nice finish to this. You know, wow, I'm really, really impressed with this, actually. A wild poppy blood orange chili. One of the more interesting, well, I don't even know what to call this. I guess a juice drink. Anyway, yeah, if you get a chance to try this, definitely try this out. I think you'll really like that, the complexity of this. So wild poppy blood orange chili. I'm going to go full 5 out of 5 drinking horns on this for sure. Definitely one of the more interesting drinks I've had in quite a while. All right, so let's wrap this up with a quotation. And I was looking up for quotations about audio, and I found one from Frank Darabont, Dorabo. Man, not with it with the pronunciations today. He's a director. And he was saying this about the movie The Exorcist, but I think it applies well to video games as well. So anyway, see what you think. It goes something like this. The Exorcist is amazing because it recognizes that silences can be as powerful as sound effects. See you guys next week.
Good, let's get rid of it.